Hello and welcome to In Depth. My name is Aditi Nagpal Kirotra. The NDA government's efforts to promote a cashless economy received a major boost last week when media reports stated that the United Payments Interface transactions crossed 1 billion in October. It was another milestone for digital payments in India 3 years after the technology-backed payment solution was launched. The latest achievement comes in the wake of another milestone being reached by the UPI when it notched up a figure of 100 million users. It made the UPI app the fastest adopted among all payment systems anywhere in the world. After these twin features in domestic market, the UPI is now all set for a global rollout. The National Payments Corporation of India that set up the UPI is presently working to enable its use in Singapore and the United Arab Emirates. While the measures to take UPI global are in the planning stage and various permissions have to be acquired to give shape to the exercise, let's look at in detail what is the UPI, what is the reason for its success, and how will its going global help the economy, and also how does it fit in the architecture of Digital India. Years after launching India's own domestic payments platform, the NPCI, which operates the Unified Payments Interface, is now aiming to find acceptance for it in Singapore and the UAE. Both countries have already opened up to India's RuPay cards and talks are on to initiate the UPI payment services too. Here's a report.
The Unified Payments Interface, or UPI, India's domestically grown payments platform, hit a landmark of 1 billion transactions in October. It also crossed 100 million users, which made it the fastest adoption of a payment system anywhere in the world. The UPI reached both milestones within 3 years of its launch. As a real-time payment system, UPI has over 141 banks on board right now and has become a major payments alternative to debit, credit and e-wallets. UPI is a payment interface of the National Payments Corporation of India, or NPCI, an umbrella organization to operate retail payments and settlement systems in India.
Presently, UPI in India has done exceedingly well because in October itself there were about 100 crore transactions which has been done, which is very, in such a short, from 2016 to 2019, such a short period of time, this has happened. Going global will definitely help because today if you want to do any international transactions, you also use other payment systems. If you're going to use UPI QR code, it also makes life simpler for people who want to transfer money to those who are staying here in India, or those who are in India want to transfer money to somebody who stays in across the world. It will be same, similar and very helpful. And of course, then the flow of the digital transactions will take place faster and enable people to use this on a seamless manner.
After the double milestone, NPCI aims to take the network global by enabling acceptance of UPI in Singapore and the United Arab Emirates. On going global, Dilip Azbay, CEO of NPCI, expects the success story and acceptance of UPI in India will drive the future of UPI across other geographies as well. He says implementation of UPI in other countries is expected to solve problems faced by Indians traveling abroad due to currency conversion and non-availability of credit or debit cards. He said a model for that is already in place. China's Alipay and WeChat are accepted in 30 countries. The difference is that these are closed loop payments, while the UPI can work with any bank account. According to reports, NPCI is working to enable this feature within the next 6 months. NPCI's attempt to create a global payment product can expand the use case of UPI and make it a major challenger to credit card providers, other global digital payment systems.
as on the pattern of the other countries, as in China, 30 countries, in 30 countries their app is accepted. And I feel that going global, the major concern will be the merchant and trader acceptance platform. Account is debited immediately anywhere on UPI, but it will take some time to get it transferred to the merchant and traders. So that is the point. They are working on it, and they have your CEO of UPI, NSPI, has given a very confident statement that we will be going ahead, and this 100 million, we will be crossing 500 million in 3 years, next 3 years.
The UPI platform, which was launched in 2016, enables users to send money from their account to any account without entering bank details by using an email-like handle or scanning a QR code. While all major banks are part of the UPI network and many have proprietary apps, the open architecture of UPI enables any bank account to be accessed from any UPI app. It has enabled three players, Google Pay, Paytm and PhonePe, to dominate the market, as customers of different banks use largely these three apps and the NPCI's Bheem app to transact. These three have been the most aggressive in enrolling small merchants, including hawkers, to accept payments through the UPI. What has also helped is that UPI waived merchant fees for payments up to 100 rupees.
This will be much cheaper, much easier. People will adopt it. They are willing to adopt it. And I heard that it is being launched as a pilot project in UAE and Singapore, where the Indian population is much more. And it will be a successful and very good for the economy of the India as well, for the people of the India. It will be very easy. And I feel the credit must go to the government for initiating such steps.
NPCI data stated that in September alone, the UPI-based system recorded 955.02 million transactions worth over 1.61 lakh crore rupees, compared to 918.35 million transactions a month ago. It said on a year-on-year basis, UPI transactions increased 2.3 times or 135%. In August, the total volume of all card transactions, debit and credit, put together was 142 crore or 1.42 billion. Bureau Report, Rajya Sabha TV.
The UPI has proved to be a super successful payment system in India. Encouraged by its success in India, the NPCI, which operates the UPI platform, is aiming to take the network global. In this report, we take a look at what is a UPI platform and what are its salient features that make it so popular. The UPI plans to collaborate with global fintech companies and banks in the coming days to take it global. What could be the challenges ahead? Let's find out.
Unified Payments Interface, or UPI, is a game changer for digital payments in India. UPI is an immediate real-time payment system that helps in instantly transferring funds between the two bank accounts through a mobile platform. Hence, UPI is a concept that allows multiple bank accounts to get into a single mobile application. The idea was developed by the National Payments Corporation of India and is controlled by the RBI and IBA, that is Indian Bank Association. UPI has achieved the double milestone of 1 billion transactions as well as crossed 100 million users in October, making it the fastest adoption of any payment system anywhere in the world.
UPI is a payment process, unified payment interface, through which a digitization is being done. And it is a very fast and rather the fastest accepted globally. since it has started last 3 years, and it has crossed 1 million.
As mentioned, UPI, in case of UPI transactions, it's a dual authentication. So therefore, it's very safe in the sense that nobody can hack it or nobody can misuse it. You are the only one who is authorized to try and do the transaction. The second is, in case of UPI, the settlement of transactions across the banks, since now there are 140 banks involved and associated with UPI. So you can do settlement of transactions across the bank very fast and in a seamless manner. And it is also done on mobile. So therefore, you don't need any handled device. You don't have to give any account numbers. And therefore, very safe, secure for individuals to do transactions through UPI.
So what are UPI's unique features that make it world-class? Free fund transfer. There were days when one had to part 5% of the amount for the fund transfer. But as far as UPI is concerned, the costs are so low that the banks have made it free. Useful for small transactions. UPI's smooth and low-cost transaction has made it feasible for making small transactions, helping even small shopkeepers and consumers. It also means fewer visits to the ATMs. Privacy of bank account. In this method, one is not required to share the account number for getting money. There is a virtual payment address or UPI ID. It thus makes it more secure. Instant transfer. UPI is based on IMPS platform. Thus, it works 24/7 and one can make the payment at any time. There is no restrictions on making payments on holidays or at odd hours. Bank strikes will also not affect UPI payments. One app, many accounts. UPI has made it possible for anyone to access all their bank accounts at one place. One does not need different apps for different bank accounts. Various apps to choose from. One also gets the liberty to choose any UPI-based app from Google Play Store. It is not mandatory to use the app promoted by one's bank. No loss of interest. Unlike putting money in a mobile wallet where it does not earn any interest, in UPI one would not lose interest as the money does not leave the bank account before making a transaction. Rewards and cashbacks. Many UPI apps give rewards and cashbacks for making transactions. And in case of any complaint, one can raise it from mobile app directly.
UPI, in case of UPI transactions, it's a dual authentication. So therefore, it's very safe in the sense that nobody can hack it or nobody can misuse it. You are the only one who is authorized to try and do the transaction. The second is, in case of UPI, the settlement of transactions across the banks, since now there are 140 banks involved and associated with UPI. So you can do settlement of transactions across the bank very fast and in a seamless manner. And it is also done on mobile, so therefore you don't need any handled device, you don't have to give any account numbers, and therefore very safe, secure for individuals to do transactions through UPI.
In its report on deepening digital payments, the Nandan Nilekani Committee had recommended that it was time to take UPI global, and that is going to be a reality soon. With NPCI working to enable paying via UPI all over the world, this will be a big boost for Indians traveling to other countries. Just like their debit card or credit card, they can pay via UPI. Going global, of course, would mean making several changes, including amending UPI protocols to include currency conversion support and directly connecting UPI to global payment systems. This must be accompanied by amendments in Indian regulators.
Going globally, it will be very helpful for the Indians going abroad to make the purchases, to pay for the products, to pay for the services, and then the NRIs to send back money here.
Besides tourists, NPCI is also aiming to capture the massive remittance market for NRIs. India is currently the world's number one country in remittances. Last year, NRIs sent back $69 billion back to India, which is the highest in the world. However, in such a case, onboarding merchants and traders for UPI platform is the biggest concern. NPCI will have to rely on banks and merchant aggregators in those geographies to onboard merchants. With inputs from Anu Divan, Bureau Report, Rajya Sabha TV.
The backbone of a digital economy is hyper-connectivity, which means growing interconnectedness of people, organizations, and machines that results from the internet mobile technology and the Internet of Things. India's digital economy is expected to cross $1.5 trillion by 2025 and $1 trillion by 2022, according to KPMG report. That also predicted that mobile data usage in India, which is already high, is further expected to surge 5 times by the 2023. In this report, let's understand what is digital economy and how India is moving towards a digital-first economy.
The Digital India Programme has a vision to transform India into a digitally empowered society and knowledge economy. Faceless, paperless, cashless is one of the professed role of Digital India. Digital transaction means a payment transaction in a seamless system effected without the need for cash. This includes transactions made through digital, electronic modes wherein both the originator and the beneficiary use digital or electronic medium to send or receive money. The various digital payment methods include banking cards, USSD, AEPS, UPI, mobile wallets, banks' prepaid cards, point of sale, internet banking, mobile banking, micro ATMs. Cashless India is a journey towards a less cash economy. It is a constant endeavor to engage with all key stakeholders and to enable and create a robust digital payment acceptance infrastructure. The government has taken many steps to create a digitally empowered India, especially in rural areas. These include digital finance for rural India. Steps include creating awareness and access through common service centers. Creating awareness and access through common service centers under the Digital Saksharta Abhiyan. Many sectors like healthcare and education are also benefiting from being linked to the rising digital economy. Bheem payment and platforms like UPI integration are making it easier for people to transfer money. India's digital economy is expected to touch the $1 trillion mark by 2022. By 2030, India is expected to be a $10 trillion economy, with half of this accounted for by the digital economy.
Digital financial transactions architecture is already in place, because the NPCI was created in that format, and NPCI has done this for whether it's an Aadhaar-enabled payment system or it's UPI system or it's RuPay card system. So it's an integrated framework and architecture which enables across the community everybody to do a transaction in whichever format, deposit, withdrawal, balance inquiry or fund transfers can be done seamlessly. So the architecture design is already in place. It is being implemented to enable and empower communities to do transactions very close to the place of residence. Wherever they live, they can do seamlessly do the transition.
This government has started it vigorously to do it. Earlier, there was no such move to make India digital, cashless economy. We cannot have a cashless economy, less cash economy. We are moving towards that. And many steps have been taken for that. And it is futile to talk about that there is a cash transactions more. They will remain there. But you see the volume of digital transactions, how it has increased. So there is a lot of scope for it. People are very enthusiastic to do it. They don't carry the money now.
Mobile data usage in India, which is already high, is predicted to surge 5 times by 2023. However, India's growing digital economy will impact media and entertainment the most. There are also key sectors that can have an impact in fueling the trillion-dollar digital economy in India. Fintech sector in India has seen an upstick over the past few years. The digital currency and payments movement took the country to another realm of financial inclusion. Public services sector has been witnessing steady and efficient digital transformation across areas like e-governance and powering essential citizen services online. In enterprise and deep technology, India has been consistently witnessing many success stories, be it in terms of technology capabilities, market potential or funding. There is no doubt that startups in this sector have made their presence felt globally with their success. The IT services market in the country is set to reach $13.2 billion by the end of this year. Then there is e-commerce and consumer internet. The growth in the internet penetration across the country, along with the rise in the number of people who shop using mobile devices, have been instrumental in spearheading the rise of e-commerce and consumer internet companies in India. India's e-commerce market is set to grow three times to surpass $100 billion by 2022. The education sector in India is poised to witness major growth in the years to come, as India will have the world's largest tertiary age population and second largest graduate talent pipeline globally by the end of 2020. The internet has bridged some of that gap, and digital platforms have deeply impacted the way we learn, teach, and provide access to educational content. Travel and hospitality is one sector that enjoyed rapid online growth since the early years of this century and continues to do so. This growth can also be attributed to the increase in disposable income, especially among millennials who are changing decades of traditional travel trends. According to IBEF, the total contribution by the travel and tourism sector to India's GDP is expected to increase from $234 billion in 2017 to $492.21 billion in 2028. Bureau Report, Rajya Sabha TV.
India is making tremendous progress in the field of digital infrastructure. Broadband connectivity is reaching villages. Over 100 crore mobile phones are active in India. According to a report by Internet and Mobile Association of India, internet data is becoming the tool for service delivery. Let's analyze how all this digital progress is affecting the Indian economy.
In July 2015, the NDA government embarked on a flagship program to transform India to a digitally empowered society and knowledge economy. Called the Digital India Program, the initiative is centered on three key vision areas: digital infrastructure as a core utility to every citizen, governance and services on demand, and digital empowerment of citizens. Since its launch, significant progress has been made under the Digital India Program. In 3.5 years, more than 12,000 rural post office branches have been linked digitally. Electronic transactions related to e-governance projects in the country have increased significantly. In order to strengthen digital infrastructure, 274,246 kilometers of optic fiber connecting more than 1 lakh gram panchayats under BharatNet have been created. There's been a rapid expansion in the network of common service centers, which act as access points for delivery of various electronic services to villages in India. Positioned as strategic cornerstone of the Digital India Program, the CSE model has adopted 6 villages in the country in the pilot phase. DigiGaon, or Digital Village, is conceptualized as a connected village where citizens can avail various e-services of the central government, state governments and private players. These DigiGaons are projected to be change agents, promoting rural entrepreneurship and building rural capacities and livelihoods through community participation and collective action. The digital villages have been equipped with solar lighting facility in their community center, LED assembly unit, sanitary napkin production unit with active participation of Asha and Anganwadi workers, and also Wi-Fi Chopal. The idea behind the project, first announced in the Union Budget 2017-18, is to turn these villages into self-sustaining units. These digital villages have regular CSE services like banking, healthcare, education, financial services, and a host of other services. In financial year 2017-18, the CSEs carried out transactions worth 19,925 crore rupees against merely 182 crore rupees back in 2013-14. In the last few years, India's digital index has grown tremendously. It rose by 56% during 2014 to 2017, from 18 to 29 on a scale of 1 to 100. This has placed the country second in terms of growth among 17 emerging and mature digital economies according to McKinsey Global Institute. There's also been a steady rise in the use of internet users in the country in the last few years. Due to increased availability of mobile internet, India has around 300 million daily active users, up from 10 to 15 million daily active users in 2011. At the current pace of growth, the total number of internet users in India is expected to be 650 million by 2020. The sharpest divide in internet penetration is the urban-rural gap. As of December 2017, 64% of urban India was on the internet, while only 20% of rural India. Besides, the government has also introduced a number of initiatives like digital lockers to share documents electronically. The cloud storage service is now being used by millions of Indians. To enable digital payments, the government launched the Bharat Interface for Money, the BHIM app. As per data from the National Payments Corporation of India, the app was used to facilitate 913 million transactions during the financial year ending 31st March 2018 with a value of 1 trillion rupees. Further, in order to make citizens digitally literate, the Pradhan Mantri Grameen Digital Saksharta Abhiyan was launched. It aims to reach around 40% rural households by covering one member from every eligible household by 31st March 2019. The Digital India Initiative is not only creating empowerment but also generating employment opportunities and promoting entrepreneurship. The Digital India Initiative is transforming not just the technology space but also contributing to environmental changes. The next generation technologies will help in lowering the carbon footprint by reducing fuel consumption, waste management, greener workplaces, and thus leading to a greener ecosystem. Cloud computing technology minimizes carbon emissions by improving mobility and flexibility. Due to the multiple initiatives of the NDA government to help the country grow digitally, India managed to break into the top 100 of United Nations e-government index in 2018. The comprehensive survey, released once in 2 years, focused on gearing e-government to support transformation towards sustainable and resilient societies. With inputs from Anu Diwan, Bureau Report, Rajya Sabha TV.
And that's it from us today in In-Depth. We'll be back same time tomorrow with a focus on some other subject. In case you missed the television broadcast, you can also watch our program online on YouTube, the link for which is given below. Suggestions and feedback about the program are also welcome. Thank you for your time.